struggle, keep you near the cross, and may your troubles show that you need God, and may your battles end the way they should, and may your bad days prove that God is good. And may your whole life prove that God is good. See, may your struggles keep you near the cross. And may your troubles show that you need God. And may your
every breath that I am made. my heart to look at some things that if we're going to be disciples of Christ, we have to know our weakness. And we also have to know who to give our weakness to. Come on, man. Oh, my goodness. We got to know who to give our weakness to. I'm going to speak in cryptic terms, because a couple of weeks ago, it was now 5 weeks ago, I came to your classroom, and I was feeling down about something. Do you remember I said something had happened or what have you? And, you know, you were just saying, just hold on. Just hold on. But what you said to me is that you can't tell everybody everything. You can't tell everybody everything. And one of the reasons why, as your pastor, I decided that I was going to start going to therapy is because I needed to talk to somebody who can't say anything to anybody. You understand where I'm coming from? And part of opening up to people, you become vulnerable to certain things. God led me to that text, Elder Green. I'm talking to Donald Green. God led me to that text where it talked about you can't give your pearls. Come on, man. I don't even know why we're starting this already, right? Because God is actually saying you can't give your pearls to swine. They don't know how to clean it. They don't know how to handle it. You understand what I'm saying? To my elder brothers Greens, I just want you to know that the discussion that we've had has really opened my eyes and opened my heart to God is not calling us to tell our weakness to people. God is calling us to let him know, talk to him about it. And he can handle it. And so I'm still on my high from Wednesday. I just want you to know I'm still on my high from Wednesday. And God is good. For those who are online watching right now, you just had the opportunity of just hearing our church talk together. I'm just excited that you have chosen to be with us online. For those who are online with us, we welcome you. We ask you to share it with others. Those who may see it online and you have it on your phone, share it with others. But we are right now in worship. Somebody say amen. We are right now in worship, and we just believe that God is going to do for us what we can't do for ourselves. Tired of doing for ourselves. It's just now we're at a place where we want to turn everything over to God. I want to say this again for those who are watching online. Every second Sabbath, we go into our community. And I'm going to say this prophetically. Even if we're not in this building, Judy, even if we're not in this building, we're still going to be doing service for others. He's done so much for us. We should be open to do so much for him. How many people are happy that it's the Sabbath? Anybody here happy it's the Sabbath? I'm so glad that it's the Sabbath. I'm so glad that we have this time for ourselves with God. And so today, we just want to open up with our time for worship. Just want to share something you'll hear in the sermon later on. I posted something online that said that I had a squirrel died on my back porch. For those who saw it, I don't know who saw the post, but what happened was that I had put there's a garbage can that I have on my porch. The reason why I have this garbage can is on my porch because the dogs can't go out, so they can go outside for air or whatever and come back inside. Well, the garbage can has been there for the longest time, so every time it rained, it collected water. For me, I looked at the fact that there was more water in there so they couldn't kick it over. The dogs couldn't kick it over to go out off of the porch. And this week, as I was seeding my backyard and getting upset at God because I wanted it to rain and it did not rain, how about that? I was moving it, and I looked, and I saw that there was a dead squirrel inside of the garbage can. And, you know, it troubled me because I'm saying to myself, wow, I don't like stuff like that. I don't like spiders. I call my wife to move it. I don't, none of that stuff. But now here's a squirrel. And I tried to think of what happened. And what I believe and what the gentleman told me that he believed what happened is that the squirrel fell into the garbage can and probably struggled to come out and struggled to the point where he didn't make it or it didn't make it. what helped me to understand that was the Wednesday. I'm trying not to preach this thing. That the struggle that we go through, God offers deliverance. And now I recognize, I'm telling y'all, we're going to have a good time today in this word, that God sees my struggle as holy. Have mercy. At least you better come up here before we keep going. You know what I'm saying? Come on, sister. God sees our struggle as holy. I've never understood it until Matthew 7. That God sees our struggle. And when I saw that the squirrel didn't make it, I said, God, are you telling me that I got another chance? He said, yeah, but your struggle is not unto death. Your struggle is unto life. Are y'all ready to worship today? Come on, ready to worship today? Give God praise.
A lot of liberties because I like to be in order, but the presence of the Lord is so here right now. Can we just take a moment and just worship the Father in this moment? Oh Lord, we love you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us here this morning. You are sweet and God, you love me. And Lord, we open our hearts to you right now. Oh, how we love you. Oh, how we love you. Oh, how we love you, Lord. Oh, oh, just the sweetness of your presence, Lord. We couldn't skip this moment, God, but you are here, Lord. Set free and deliver, Lord. So we love you, Lord. Oh, oh, yes. We love you, Jesus. Can we give the Lord a praise? Hallelujah, Jesus. Pastor, I can sit there all day long. Presence and learn him. There's an expectation of exchange. When you just allow yourself to rest in the presence of the Father, knowing that everything that you need is there, that protection, that healing, that deliverance, that understanding. Pastor, while you were sitting there talking about going to the therapist, and you said, I just can't tell everybody anything, right? The hymn came to me, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs, what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Then I like the part that says, oh, trust and obey. I love that song. But I just sense that sometimes, you know, even in this walk with God, we get discouraged. And even in these spaces that we're in, you know, my birthday is Monday, right? I'll be a good 49. Thank you, Jesus. And I didn't want to celebrate this time. I just wanted to spend time with God. Because last month I had two friends that passed before the age of 45. You know, And I sat there and I was like, Lord, although I'm grateful for other folks to celebrate me, I celebrate you. Because they said I wouldn't make it past 21. And my sister's a mathematician, but 21 goes into 49 too. So God did it over and over and over and over and over and over again. So can we sing this together? If you know it, fine. You can Google it on your phone and say, no, don't kill me, okay? What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins.
Community of Hope, and good morning to everyone online. Raise your hand if you've had a really long week. I know I have. This week's felt like a month. A number of us have had a really long week, and so I want to give you guys like a quick, I wouldn't be a professor if I didn't give you a quick history lesson. I'm not a professor of history, but a quick history lesson mixed with a little story. So in the fall of 2022, I started a new job at, I work at a small Christian college called Montreat College. And I said, you know what, I'm not going to go in there being me. I'm going to sit back and be quiet because I'm always saying something. So I said, I'm going to observe. And I told myself that, Leslie Ann, you are going to observe. So we meet for faculty workshops. And I'm sitting there And one of my colleagues, he's retired now, but his name is John Pope Nelson. Dr. Nelson gets up and he does a workshop, and I see it says Sabbath rest. And I'm like, well, these are, you know, they're Presbyterian. So I said, okay. And none of them know that my religion or anything. They just know I love God. So he goes on and he says, he presents a bunch of books and literature. And he said, do you guys remember the Oregon Trail? Do any of you remember the Oregon Trail? So he says, did you guys know that the pioneers took Sabbath rest weekly and didn't get there late? And I said, what? You know, it was, I sat up a little bit. And so for those of you who like to fact check, Joseph E. Ware, The Emigrant's Guide to California, 1849. So he wrote this in 1849 on the Oregon Trail, said, never travel on the Sabbath. We will guarantee that if you lay by on the Sabbath and rest yourselves and your teams, that you will get to California 20 days sooner than those who travel 7 days in the week. So now I sat there and I'm like, Leslie, you said you're not going to say anything. But I felt my hand moving on its own, because Dr. Poe started going, you know who gets the Sabbath? He goes, oh, seven Adventists get the Sabbath. And I'm like, so I said, because all the others around me, I'm hearing them go, and they go, oh, well, you know, wow, that's amazing. That must feel wonderful to be off. And so I raised my hand slowly, and I said, I'm Seventh-day Adventist. So at that moment, they were like, but tell us about rest. And so I said, I've never known life without a Sabbath rest. And they were like, what? So I never know. My parents are Edson and Delaverne Bovell. Their parents taught them about the Sabbath. So they taught me that it was a sacred practice. And I said, so in my home, I would hear, and I said, if I had to pick three themes, the themes that I would pick would be fellowship, worship, and rejuvenation. So that now they're sitting back all listening to me. First day together. And I said, they created an atmosphere for us, which means we turned off the TV, we didn't work, I didn't see them working, and we did catered our time to worship, fellowshipping, and rejuvenation. And I've practiced that throughout my entire life. So I said to them, during my dissertation, I shut it down on Friday night and didn't pick it back up. During any type of school activity, I did the same thing. Even in now, work and business, I don't touch it. And I said, I've never missed anything. So I, they're right. And so at that point, everybody was just like, we're going to. So now my colleagues, I remember talking to one of my colleagues, and she told me the other day, she's like, my Sabbath rest is Sunday sunset to Saturday sunset to Sunday sunset. And she's, life is completely different for her now that she's prioritized the Sabbath. And so today I want us to embrace Sabbath. Let's fully disconnect. Put away the phones, no work, no rushing around. Try your best to push the word to the side. Maybe, just maybe, by giving ourselves this time to recharge, we can tackle that project. We can get to that homework later. Maybe the tasks will not only be done sooner, but better. Let's not underestimate the power of rest. Welcome to Community of Hope. Welcome to those online. Let's fellowship a little bit by greeting each other. Happy Sabbath.
Hey everyone, this is your servant, Pastor Paul Graham. I want you to know that I'm excited for the very fact that you decided to watch us today, to be online with us today. You could be anywhere else. There's so many churches you could be watching right now, so many programs, but you decided to join us today. We want to thank you for joining us and share this with others. Today, we're going to be talking about your struggle being holy. And so if you want to learn more or hear more about this, stay tuned. Enjoy the worship today. We want you to know that the Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So again, thank you for joining us, and we're so grateful that you decided to be with us today. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Easy to love. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. It's so easy. It's so easy. It's so, so easy. Easy to love. I love you when you can't do nothing about it, yeah. I love you when you can't do nothing about it. Oh, it's so easy. Thank you, it's so easy. It's so easy. Easy to love. I love you when you can't do nothing about it, yeah. Do nothing about it, oh, it's so easy. It's so easy. It's so easy. Easy to love. The Holy Ghost in me loves the Holy Ghost in you. Holy Ghost in me. Love the Holy Ghost in you. It's so easy. So easy. So easy. It's easy to love. The Holy Ghost in me loves the Holy Ghost in you. Holy Ghost in me loves the Holy Ghost in you. It's so easy. It's so easy. Easy to love. Easy to love. So easy.
Give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. Ready to lift the name of the Lord high? This is an oldie but good. I thought that was mine. Oldie but goodie, if you remember, if you're from D.C., T.D. Jakes took it, but the earth. your holy name. Oh Lord, we lift your name up high in all the earth. Oh, high in all the earth. Oh, high in all the earth. This part says, we lift your name high. We lift your name high. High in all the earth. as your presence now fills this hallelujah. 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 Oh, we lift hallelujah. Can we lift it one more time? Hallelujah. 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 Hey. Hallelujah. 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 Can we lift, Lord, we love you, Lord. Lord, we love you, oh, Lord, we love you. Lord, we love you, Lord, we love you, Lord, we love you, Lord, we
that y'all keep playing that. Just give me a moment, y'all. This is the presence of the Lord is here. I don't think y'all heard me. The presence of the Lord is here. So let me explain that to you, what that means. I'm going to translate that for you. All right, because this is our time. It's the garden of prayer. I say this every Sunday. So for those that are online and those that are in here, shameless plug, every Sunday at 7 p.m., we do something called the Sunday Prayer Room. Anybody that wants to join us is invited to the Sunday Prayer Room. Now, in the Sunday Prayer Room, I make it plain that as we are about to talk to God, I remind everybody, and I'm reminding you here, that we serve a limitless God that can and will do limitless things. That's the God that we're going to today. The other thing that I want to share with y'all is God gave us permission to come to his throne of grace. Right? And he tells us to come in two ways, and we do one pretty well, but the other one we have a problem with. God tells us to come to his throne of grace both humbly, which we do well, But the other way that God tells us to come to him is boldly. And we struggle with that. So I'm helping y'all today not to struggle with that by reminding y'all again that we serve a limitless God that can do limitless things. And I know my limitless God has done something very good for some of y'all, if not all of us, because we're here. We're breathing. We got oxygen. God woke us up this morning and started us on our way. But I'm looking for 2 to 3 testimonies. I'm looking for 2 because I'm going to give 1. 2 testimonies. And I'm going to start off first. I see you, Sister Gloria. And I see you, Brother Green. Come on up. Just come on up. My testimony, it's actually 2. 1 is real small. My baby is home. And I'm going to say it loud and proud. I am the happiest man in the world right now because my wife, who had been gone for almost 3 weeks, is back in our kingdom. My queen is home. So I'm happy about that. Praise God for my queen. Love you, Leah. My other testimony is going to sound a little bit weird, okay? I got fired from my job this week. I heard somebody say, what? Like, that's a bad thing. It's not. It's not. Here's why it's not a bad thing. God gave me this job. And if I had time, I'd tell you how God did it, right? It was a miracle that I got this job. Because I didn't even apply for it. I got a call. I got a call. And somebody offered me this job. All right? So I knew that was God. But I've been having, management had changed, and I've been having problems with my new manager. So, to the point where for 2 weeks straight, I didn't get hours at my job. So, I simply said, okay, God, if this is your way of telling me that it's time to go, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to let you make the decision. So, if they want me to leave, they're going to have to tell me that they want me to leave. I'm not going to quit. Because I really want to know where you're leading me. I got a call 2 days ago. Stay in the middle. I got a call 2 days ago. You got me like 2 days ago with the great news that I'm no longer needed there. Now, let me tell you why that's significant. I've been wrestling with God since the beginning of 2024. Here's been my prayer to God. God, the only employer that I want is you. I don't want to be employed by nobody else. And God said, okay, cool. Let me take this away from you. Now you ain't got no excuses. You got to do what I tell you to do. So those are my 2 testimonies. Ladies for gentlemen, right? So Sister Gloria, come on up. Oh, nah, no end. This is the beginning. Look, this is the beginning of new. And I don't know what new looks like. All I know is this, that God has my whole family in transition, and we're going to trust where God takes us. That's it. I ain't got no plans. The only plan I got is God's plan. And God's got control of that. I'm just going to walk in it. So here's my prayer request. I need y'all to pray for me because I do struggle with one thing, and that's the fear of failure. And God really hit me over the head with that, right? Because I allow the fear of failure to cause me to stop and quit. And in this season, God doesn't want me quitting. He wants me going. All right? So with that said, come on. I call her. This is my gangster in the spirit right here.
I am on the battlefield. All right. So, no, Pastor. You know, I've been on it. What is with these lights? But I've been on this thing with the Lord, with Luke 9. You know, the Lord and I have been on this Luke 9. One, you know, about us having him giving us power and authority. I believe those words. I am claiming those words over demons and over health. I'm claiming it. But anyway, so I believe that. I think that I can heal and I can keep demons at bay. I believe that through the power of God. So since that has been my belief, you think the enemy is pleased? So this week, Sharon and I were in a situation where we needed the power over demons of intimidation and meanness. And here we are. But here I am. Because the devil pushed me down on Thursday. I hit the floor. Bam! And I got a banged up knee and a finger that's kind of pushed out of joint. But I'm like, Lord, I don't care how much this knee is swollen up. Ronald Green has given me money, and so has his daughter, and I have got to buy stuff for distribution today, for today. That was Thursday. I'm like, Friday, I don't have time to deal with no banged up knee and anything else. I got to hit the stores. And I did. And I'm banged up, but I'm here. But it just goes to show that if you are on the battlefield for the Lord, you're going to get some nicks. You're going to get some bruises. You got to shake it off and keep moving. Hopefully. And one thing about being old and an Adventist for a long time is you heard a whole lot of health messages. I put a slice of onion on that big knot on my knee. I did. Thursday, I put a slice of onion on my, and rested my leg up on that pillow in my bed. And when I got up Friday morning, the swelling was down. Don't fool with an old Adventist. Y'all, young people, y'all better read that stuff. Now, my goddaughter is a nurse. She's like, go to the emergency room. I said, I don't have time. I don't have time. But God is a healer. So get on the battlefield. Go on and take your knocks and bruises because you're going to get knocked down. I told Judy she almost fell or did fall because this is distribution week. This distribution week. May 11th is our next one. Just go ahead and expect some problems. We're going to have them that whole week. We're going to have them. We're going to have them. So what you need to do is slow down, stay in prayer, and learn the name of Jesus if you don't ever know it. Keep it on your tongue because he's going to come get you. But he's already defeated, but that doesn't mean he doesn't stop fighting. But God is going to protect us because we are on the battlefield for our Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on up here, Elder Green.
Praise the Lord. Wednesday, I testified on prayer meeting how God blessed me to fix some doors. I work here at the school and how I got them fixed. And they back up. Well, Tuesday, we have some more doors messed up, Pastor. But I testify about the ones downstairs. These ones were the ones right outside. And Wednesday night when I went to bed, I said, Lord, you know, I can't figure out what's wrong with this door out here. So I called my son who works on doors, and he gave me some things, told me some things, and I was like, okay, yeah, that sounds good. That sounds okay. I said, but it's something about this door. It's not right. So I talked to my boss. I said, man, listen. This door, what we think is wrong with this door is not. I said, something under this door. And my son said that there are some things under the metal doors that you have to be careful with. So it kind of scared me about working on the door. And I said, well, we really can't afford to call people. Because the last time we had a guy come and talk about doors, that's another whole story. Lou Abner. So Wednesday night passed after I finished testifying about doors downstairs. Got in the bed. Holy Ghost said, there's something underneath that door, Ronald. And what it is, he said, it's a rubber door stopper underneath that door that's causing the door not to close. But we thought it was the door closer. So my boss put a new door closer on there. So I came to work Thursday because I don't work on Wednesdays. And he said, man, I put a new door stopper on that thing, and that thing's still not working. I said, it's a rubber doorstopper under that door. He said, what you mean? I said, it's a rubber doorstopper under that door. He said, how you know? I said, because the Lord told me last night. So he said, no. I said, okay. I said, all right. So we started banging on the door. And I said, look at this. Something hanging out from here for just a little bit. So we couldn't grab it. So we tried to grab it and try to pull it. He said, I said, listen, man, I know what it is. So he went and got a screwdriver. Said, get a screwdriver and get something. And he knocked it out. And I was on this side of the door. He was on the other side of the door. And when he knocked it out, he came over there. He said, boy, it's a rubber door stopper under that door. And the doors are working. And I just want to thank God for being a God who's interested in the little things. In the little things. The thing is, even though it's a little thing, it can be an embarrassment. Because this is a school. And people come in there all the time. And if the door's not working, they look at all that. And they begin to judge us, God's people, a certain way. You know, so I said, Lord, you know what? I appreciate you showing me and helping me to get things right. So when people come in here, they don't see it in a way that it bad mouth us. You know, because people come in and some people want to support you, but, you know, everybody's attitude not the same. So I just thank God for being a God who's interested and a God who listen and communicate with his son. Because I need to hear him speak to me about different issues in my life. And he's been doing it. But so I want you to pray for me that my faith will not fail. And I will keep on holding on and wearing the armor of God.
Wow. Praise the Lord. It's amazing how little things can have a big impact, right? And that's why I want to, like I said, the Holy Spirit's here, the Holy Spirit's leading. We just sang a song at the beginning of the service, and I want to just read some of the words of this song. We just sang it. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless, you hear that? Needless pain we bear. Why? All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Again, some more words. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? You hear that? Jesus knows our every weakness. So take it to the Lord in prayer. Again. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms, he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find solace there. We have an opportunity, and we have this opportunity every day. And if we're honest, everything that I just read, we're guilty of doing. But we gotta stop. We tend to think that we have shoulders big enough to deal with some things. So we tend to give God the big things. But Elder Green just gave us a perfect testimony of how God can deal with the little things. And when God deals with the little things, the profound impact it has, not just on us as individuals, but a whole community. So, I am inviting all of us here to cast all, say all, cast all of your cares, regardless of how big or how small it is. Let's take all these things to the Lord in prayer. So this is what I want to do. Simple instructions. Anybody want a financial blessing? Here. Having financial troubles? Here. Marriages and relationships? Here. Sickness and health? Here. If all of the above, pick one. We'll pray because we're praying for all of it. But come on us. Remember, financial situations and blessings here. We're taking it all to the Lord in prayer. Relationships and marriages here. Health here. No, family and marriages here. Health over there. Finances over here. You're not alone. I'm going to pick on you, Professor Pierre. I want you to pray for those that are in that section. Pastor Graham, could you pray for the... I'm going to be down here with you. And who... Sister Green, can you pray for health? All right, before we pray, I want to do one thing, and I want the music to keep going, okay? I want us to close, everybody close your eyes. All right? And on my count, I want us to take some deep breaths because it's time to get centered. Why? Because we are in the presence of a holy God, our holy King. And so there should be nothing in our hearts and our minds that would distract us from having a conversation with God. This is holy ground, a sacred space where we get to communicate with our God. So with that said, let's clear our minds of everything else. Let's take our first deep breath. Again, in. Last time, in and out. God, we are here to talk to you and to hear from you. So please listen keenly to every word that we have to say in Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. We want to thank you for this opportunity that you have given us. It's a gift that you've given us to sit at your feet and talk to you. Sit at your feet and cast all our cares on you, because that's what you want from us. God, I am so grateful that you are a limitless God that can do limitless things. God, we have an issue with inviting you into the smaller issues of our lives. God, I am asking right now that you would search our hearts, our minds, and our souls. You know everything that we're concerned about. And my prayer is, even for those things that we're not praying for, God, that you will show up in those spaces in such a way that it will convince us to not leave you out of any area of our lives. Thank you, God, for not just keenly listening. Thank you, God, for not just keenly hearing, but thank you, God, for moving on our behalf. And God, we are excited to see what it is that you will do for us. So right now, I'm giving you praise and thanks in advance for all that you will do for us, God. You are a God that answers prayers even in 2024. And so we trust you, God. We place our hope in you, and we say thank you, God. In Jesus' name we all pray. Amen.
I was sitting in my seat and I kept hearing the scripture that says, God will open doors that no man can shut. And the one part for me that God made very clear, speaking of this door stopper under the door, he told you the door is going to be open. But a lot of it is not the fact that he won't open the door or that the door is not open. We got to get up underneath our doors and figure out what we have to clean out. Thank you, Elder Green, for that. Because it spoke volumes to me and it released something in myself that I needed. Amen. So I tell y'all, I'm trying to keep my composure today. Now, amen. We're going to worship the Lord further with this song, and it's resting on me real good today. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. So good to me. Before I took the breath, you breathed your life in me.
gave yourself away. All the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, finds till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Praise the Lord. Before we even begin, I want to just simply share that we could just go home. I'm almost got Brooklyn. I'm dead up, you know. Before we move forward, I'm going to do something a little bit different because I've got permission, not from the leadership team, but I got permission from the clerk. And whatever she says, I do. Donald Green, I want to just make sure that I do this correctly. Looking for Sister Sharon Green. Some time ago, you put your membership in. And usually we have a board meeting first or leadership meeting first to vote whether we will accept you into Community of Hope as members. But I want you to understand that according to Robert's Rules of Order in the North American Division, it goes to the board first and then it comes to the church at large. Well, the board is in the church at large right now. And I just want to be clear that before I do this, I just want to let you know that we're grateful that you sent for your membership, the both of you, to Community of Hope. Now I'm asking the church if you deem fit or them fit. And I don't think anyone's fit to be a member. I think we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. God has called our names to be written on the Lamb's Book of Life, not necessarily on a membership roll. But church, I'm making a motion that we accept Brother Donald Green and Sister Sharon Green to be members of Community of Hope. Is there a second? Is there a second? So all in favor, say aye. Is there any opposed? The same sign? Then it's carried. I'm going to ask for Donald Green and Sharon Green to come forward at this time. I know you weren't ready for it, but it's exciting for me. And I'm excited for this. I don't know that Lauren Rowe is not here today, but his membership came through last meeting, but I just want to make sure that you recognize that you are recognized by our church as now members of Community of Hope. Amen. This here is for you right here, and this is for you. And I want to share something with you as I'm waiting for someone with a camera or with a phone to take this picture. I have been a pastor for 30 years. I have never, ever seen a church, and maybe Sister Davies, maybe you can let me know, I've never seen a church give out a certificate for being a member. I've never seen that before. Sister Davies, have you seen that before? I know you, your husband, been pastoring for years and what have you. I've never seen it before. This church is teaching me some new things. Oh, in the middle? Me? That sounds good. All right. Here we go. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, boss. We just recognize that Amanda, she's probably not going to come up here, but I'm not afraid of her. Amanda Phillips is here in church. She was one of our first baptisms with me here. And the others have their baptismal certificates, but I have yours here, Amanda. I'm not coming down there to get it, to give it to you. So I'm going to wait for you to come and get your baptism. She said, your baptismal certificate. And we just want you to know that December 9th, 2023, that's when she was baptized at Community of Hope. And so I'm going to ask her if she'll come up and receive her baptism certificate. I'm not coming down there, just saying, you know. And we can't start service until you pick up your certificate. Amen. Put your hands together again for Amanda Phillips. While she is coming down, on May 11th is our next baptism. Amen. I want Brother Keon to know that the work that they are doing back there is amazing. Someone asked for baptism who was online. And so they have been following the online church since last year, December. And they have decided to give their hearts to God in baptism. And so on May 11th will be our next baptism. And we're hoping that we will celebrate with this individual. So, Amanda? That's right, that's right. There we go, there we go. And so, Amanda, I want to give you this baptismal certificate right here. Can you get this? Thank you so much. Let me, yes, I know. I know she's slapping me in my back. And what's so beautiful about this, before we even go into this word, Amanda and myself and two other individuals, we went for a drive to New York. And while we're on that drive, at least to New York, I was doing a funeral for a friend that we all grew up with. And while we were talking in the car, she says, I'm ready. And I believe that you are here today for this sermon, Amanda, because what we talked about in the car, I didn't understand it until this week. I ain't scared of none of y'all today. I asked my wife to pray for me because I feel like preaching. It's like when you're watching a television show by yourself and something happens and you want to turn to someone real quickly. I've been on this television show since last Tuesday. So Father, bless this word in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you will, turn with me to Matthew chapter 7. I'm smiling already. I'm just excited. Matthew chapter 7. And Amanda, I'm sorry for calling you like this, but I wish I knew what I knew when we were talking about this. But God is closing this door on how we should feel about ourselves in our struggle. Have mercy. The word of God teaches, judge not that ye be not judged. Anyone has a different version from the King James Version? What do you have there? Just go ahead, Sister Green. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. Look at what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, judge not that ye be not judged. Judge not, because you can fall into the same issue too. We're talking about a God that's perfect making a statement to imperfect people. The Bible says in verse 2, for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. Sister Green, what does yours say? And in the same way that you judge others, you will be judged. God is not saying, listen, family, God is not saying that you should not be checked. And God is also not saying that we should not, Sister Glory, be held accountable. I want to be clear about that. But many times, judgment comes with what you think should be done to that person. There are many times when I thought to myself that I'm judging others, that this should happen to that person because of what they have done. And God is saying, who do you think you are? Today, I recognize that I was judging people. I'm just giving you an example. While we're standing out there and people are coming in, all right, I see nice cars coming, and I say they're not going to turn because they don't need it. I see other cars coming. Did you hear what I said? Other cars coming. And I'm dancing more for them with the signs because I'm thinking that by what they drive is what they need. But I was judging. Now, it may not be judging unto sin, but what I did was I put someone in a category that God didn't put them in. I need you to know that God is showing us right now through his word, verse 2, that for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. Please, if you read that part again, please, Sister Green. And with the measure you use, it will be used for you, hoping not against you. So the word says in verse 3, and why beholdest thou the mote in thy brother's eye, but consider not the beam that is in your own eye? I want to be clear, right, that this is not the text that we're preaching from. It's the setup. The Bible is telling us that Jesus is saying, I recognize that you are able to see the speck in someone's eye. But you're not able to see the plank in yours. Now, let's not forget that Jesus was a carpenter. So he knows what specks in our eyes may be. My brother was telling me in his study of it that the speck in the eye is better than the splinter in your eye. He says, I'd rather have a speck in my eye because my grandmother would come to me and open my eye and blow in my eye and whatever was in there came out. I don't know if anybody else that happened to. But if you have a splinter in your eye, Sister Gloria, you blowing in somebody's eye is not going to take that splinter out. That's why sometimes a good song would get that speck out. Sometimes a good sermon would get that speck out. Sometimes meditation would get that speck out. But many of us, when you have a splinter in your eye and you blink, you feel it every time you blink. Verse 4, Sister Green, if you will, please.
How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, and when all the time there is a plank in your own eye?
Mercy, keep reading.
You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye.
Have mercy. If anybody who was with us on Wednesday, do you recognize Sister Green read the same text on Wednesday, and she said, you hypocrites, the same way again? She said, you hypocrites. When she said, you hypocrites on Wednesday, I said, oh gosh, is she talking to me? When you said it just now, it is revealing that hypocrisy, listen everyone, hypocrisy is not that you're struggling. Hypocrisy is when you're defining your struggle from someone else's. You see, what's so amazing about this is that Jesus calls the person that's calling out someone else a hypocrite because they sin differently. So what I'm recognizing here is that Jesus is saying to those who's identifying the sinner, check yourself first. I want you to hear this, everyone. Jesus never said that you can't call somebody out. He said, just don't call somebody out with the beam in your eye. Because when you straighten yourself out, Then you can call someone else out. And I recognize this. Elder Green, Donald Green, Ronald Green, the Greens. I always say this. It's important to understand that if the beam is out of your eye and you're checking someone else, you're going to check them properly. The only way that we judge others unto death and we judge others unto negativity is when we haven't straightened ourselves out yet. But if you straighten out your life first, your issue first, and then you deal with someone else, they are open to hear their mistakes. They're open to hear their issues. I'll give you an example. I ain't scared of none of y'all. Sister Gloria, and I'm sorry to use it as an example. The other day, we had a wonderful, wonderful conversation from the pulpit. We did. We talked about discipleship. We were in it. And while we were in it, I mentioned something in the sermon that when I was driving away, when I left here, the Holy Spirit said, man, why you talk about that for? You didn't need to talk about that. You're stuck on something, and you needed to throw it in there. The next day, I get a text from one of the members. I'm not going to tell you who it is, Sister Gloria. What I want you to understand is what she said and how she said it. I couldn't help but repent. I know you didn't miss it. She could have said it. But the way she said it was, thank you for the message. It was God sent. But if we did it this way, then it wouldn't have been this way. But I heard God telling me while driving here. So then when she sent it to me, she sent it checking the spec, knowing that she was able to say something to me so that I can change. Did y'all hear that just now? She was operating through the Holy Spirit. And the reason why I'm saying that, Sister Gloria, I'm not telling you to keep telling me what I'm doing wrong. And you didn't even say I did something wrong. What you said was, consider this next time. When the beam is out of our own eye and we're telling someone that there's an issue, you're going through the Holy Spirit. Because now when you go through the Holy Spirit, you're able to help other individuals realize, hey, I'm on the wrong track here. So give not verse 6, give not that which is, I'm sorry, let me go back. So when you cast that out of your eye, recognize that you are sinners saved by grace. Do you understand that? You're sinners, you're messed up. Everyone here is messed up, so we need each other. I know, don't miss this. So we need each other to help each other recognize where we're going wrong. Oh, boy. Just don't do it with beams in your eyes. You see, the world wants us to use this text and say, don't say anything to anybody. But if we are going to be a true church, we have to be able to say, there's a problem here. I'm only helping you because it helps me. Or I'm only helping you because someone helped me. There's nothing in here that talks about exposing you. What this talks about is exposing a loving God in our lives. Woo, somebody. So then, Sister Green, I recognize, listen to this, Daryl, listen to this. I want you to hear this, that what God now says in verse 6 now makes sense this week than in 30 years. If you're watching online, don't just watch. Open your Bibles. Look at this. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 7, verse 6, give not that which is holy unto the dogs. Neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you and break you. And I never understood what this meant. I had to talk to my daddy last night about this because I recognized that Jesus was telling people who are struggling, don't tell everybody your issue. Don't let everybody know you're struggling. Hey. Because they can't handle it. Who told us to sing "What a Friend We Have in Jesus"? That's who we need to talk to. The only problem why we won't talk to God is because we feel we're not going to get the answers immediately from him. But it's better than talking to us or what we want to hear. But if we talk to others, they can't handle your issue. So I tried to look at this, Ella Green. I tried to look at this. Kat's parents, good to see you all. Catherine's mom and dad, right? Good to see you all. It is important to understand what is holy. Judy, I'm about to mess you up. What is holy? I'm looking at the text, Sister Campbell. I'm looking at the text, and I'm asking the question, give not that which is holy unto the dogs. What's holy? Then he says, neither cast your pearls before swine. I ain't got no pearls. And most of the times, John, listen, most of the times, I consider myself unholy. Got a call this week. Can't tell y'all yet. Got a call this week to enter into another realm of ministry. And I've struggled because I asked myself the question, am I even worthy? You know, my next statement was, I'm not, Mr. So-and-so, I'm not giving up my church. I didn't say you had to. Are you understanding where I'm coming from? I want to be careful, Sister Gloria. I want to be careful. But I thought that I can't do it. Judy, I can't do it. John, I can't do it. I can't do it because I'm not good enough. What if somebody find out about the chink in my armor? What if somebody finds out that I struggle with something? What if somebody finds out that I like to cuss every now and then? That's not me. I'm just telling you. That ain't my issue. I'm fear to say that's not my issue. It was, but it's not. So what's holy? I want us to understand that God is saying, Jay, I want you to hear this, that the struggle that you're going through in your life, as long as you're struggling with Jesus in the struggle, your struggle is holy. Well, listen, I'm not afraid to say, I'm not afraid to say this to you, because as a preacher, we're supposed to tell you to attain. And according to the word, you can't attain without God. No one is born attaining. I look back at the life of John the Baptist. Stay with me, family. Look up at life. And when we look at John, it's Jesus who says, no better prophet come from a woman like this man John. Yet it was John that sat there and said, is this guy real? Anybody remember that? This perfect man John said, is this guy real? Go and find out if he's really my cousin, if my cousin is really the Messiah. This is the same one who was thought of before he was to bring Jesus into existence. Come on, somebody. This is the voice, Isaiah, crying in the wilderness. Now he's the one saying, is this guy for real? And I want you to understand that John sinned. Uh-oh, are you all right? Yet found worthy enough to speak on behalf of a Jesus. So when I look at this, I find out what is holy. Holy is when that temptation hits you and you're struggling and you want to do it. Your body says yes, you want to smoke. Your body says yes, you want to drink. Your body says yes. And folk, don't look at me like, is there a drink a sin? Is smoking a sin? I'm saying that if the Holy Spirit is telling you that you shouldn't be doing it, and you're hearing it, and you're struggling with it, and you're not doing it, God calls your struggle holy. And the reason why I'm sharing this with you is because I've never understood this thing called holy. Holy is what you attain to be. And while you're attaining to be this, God sees you're trying. Hold on. Come on. You're right. If you are trying, then he steps in with his righteousness. The word of God teaches us. This is what the Bible teaches. When there's more sin, there's more grace. Yet he's not telling us to sin. He's not allowing us to sin. He's not telling you that you are allowed to sin so I can give you grace. He's saying while you're struggling not to sin, I call you holy. And you're so hard on yourself. You're being so difficult on yourself. Now I'm finding, judge not that ye be not judged. Stop judging you. Stop giving yourself a hard way to go. I want you to understand that you are still acting like there's a beam in your eye. You took the speck out and you're still blinking like there's a problem. You're a hypocrite to yourself. You're clean and acting dirty. You smell better than you ever smell, but you're just not used to it. Can I share something with you? I got three dogs. And I want you to understand that the other day, the other week, my wife came into the house. She said, man, I'm smelling urine in this house. I'm saying, I don't smell no urine in the house. She said, I'm smelling urine in the house. I said, I don't smell no urine in the house. Friend of mine came over. I said, you smell urine in the house? She said, yeah, I smell urine in the house. So why? Then why? How come I can't smell the urine in the house? Because I've been in the house with the urine till I got used to the smell. And anybody with me so far? Sometimes we're so used to us, we won't let Jesus in the house to let us know that we need to change. We won't allow the Holy Spirit in. And many of us, I'm going to say this much, I got to share this with you, that one of the mistakes that I made was that I wasn't cleaning the floor properly. I'm mad, not because I don't smell it. I'm mad because I cleaned it and they still smell it. I want you to understand that the reason why I'm upset is not that I can't smell it. The reason I'm upset because I just cleaned the floor. And I'm going to tell you right now, I didn't use a mop. I got on my knees, and I cleaned it like an old Southerner. Don't get mad, y'all. I cleaned it like my old grandmother cleaned that floor. And the issue was that I didn't clean the mess first. I cleaned the mess with the detergent. I figured that if I cleaned the floor with the detergent over the mess, that the mess will go away. But you had to clean the mess first and then use the detergent. So what they were smelling was the mixture of the urine and the cleaning agent. Oh boy, come on somebody. And I'm recognizing now that the smell of the urine is greater than the detergent. So if you want to clean the mess out, I mean, if you want the place to smell clean, you got to clean the mess first. That could be hot water. That could be hot water and a little bit of soap. And when the mess is clean, you go over it with the detergent. They got a new detergent out now for dog owners. That this one, when you clean it, it comes with a formula that the dog can't smell where he was before. Boy, I told you I felt like preaching today. One of the problems with us in our lives, number one, we're so used to our smell. that even though we come to church, even though we pray, even though we have worship, we still smell ourselves. God is telling us, don't mix that. Use me. Don't go back on your old smell. Don't judge yourself on your past. And if you're struggling, thank you for struggling instead of giving up with the struggle. Because as you struggle and I see your struggle, I call you holy. And then there's a detergent that's used that when you're clean and you're struggling and you attain, you hear that? And you're delivered. Remember, you're delivered. You're holy when you're delivered. And you're holy during the struggle. You're unholy when you stop struggling. Some of y'all looking at me like I'm crazy, but I want you to understand something. That what God is saying is, once you're delivered, trust me that when I continue to keep you clean, continue, it's not a one-time baptism thing, that you can't even smell where you've been. You ever had a sin in your life that when God delivered you from that sin was nasty to you now? You don't even want to return to the vomit anymore. I'm sharing this with you because we cannot keep giving what's holy to the dogs. Dogs don't know what to do with your stuff. They don't know what to do with your issues. They don't know what to do with your sins. Cast your sin on him. Cast your issues on him. This is why when it comes to the Catholic Church or any other church or any other church that does this, don't come to Pastor Graham and tell him, I need to confess my sins. I don't know what to do with your stuff because I don't know what to do with mine. People call me all the time, Pastor, I've done this, I've done wrong, I've done so-and-so. I'm like, yo, hold up a second, hold up. Talk to God and come back and cry. But don't tell me because I am not your mediator. I can tell you who to run to. Come on, somebody. I can tell you who to call on. Come on, somebody. I can tell you where I've been and where I'm going. But I cannot do anything for your sins. Don't give it to the dogs. Y'all not hearing me? Don't give it to the dogs. And when I say don't give it to her, I'm grateful that you want to give it to me. But I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know what to do with it. Because when you give your stuff to dogs, they don't understand what's holy and what's good. Let me give you an example. My two dogs are my two dogs. The last one is my wife's dog. My two dogs are not going to, if I drop my watch, my $100-something watch on the ground, my two dogs are not going to chew it up. My wife's dog, new, year and some old, we got to pick everything up from the floor because this dog chews up everything. But my other two dogs, they're 15 years old. They're old. They know what's going to get me upset. They know what to chew and what not to chew. Sometimes I think those other two look at that one dog and say, you in trouble. So you can't just leave anything around to anybody. Oh, come on now. You don't take your problems and give it to somebody. They don't know what to do with it. They'll chew it up. And then you want to take your pearls. Come on. Now, the reason why I want to share this with you concerning the pearls is that a pearl is not just made in a day. That's why I want to be careful when I say this, that Amanda, you've been baptized. Others who have been baptized, others who will be baptized, there's a level of spirituality that needs to keep going. In other words, you need to be in prayer meeting. You need to be around people that will straighten you up. It's okay. If I know you love me and you straighten me up, I'm fine. I don't care what it is. I said I'm fine. If you talk behind my back, there's a problem. Help me to be better. Then I want you to know that there's the reading of the Word of God. There's eating at each other's house. There's eating at each other's house. just eating some folks' food that's really good. That's spiritual. When we eat with one another, it's spiritual. When we hang with each other, it's spiritual. That's how we become stronger, Sister Gloria. That's how we become stronger. And I want you to understand that one of the mistakes we always make is that we don't recognize that pearls take time to be made. Just because you got baptized today doesn't mean you got it. Just because you heard a sermon today and it did it for you means you've got it. You got to deal with Saturday night and Sunday and Monday and Tuesday. And even though God is saying to you, you are pearls. We look at our pearls as underdeveloped. Like it's not worthy. And Jesus is saying to you, Del, he's saying to me, we had a nice talk driving to Pennsylvania one day, and we recognized we got our issues. And before we got out the car, I was like, don't say nothing. The truth of the matter is, what can I do for you and you do for me but pray for one another? But I can't take my problems and give it to the pigs. The pigs don't know the difference. They'll take your pearls and trample over the development of your life with Christ. There's some pastors you can't talk to. You tell them that you have an issue, the first thing they want to do is have a conversation with the board. Got a call the other day from someone. Pastor, I'm going through this and I'm going through that, but I was told, Pastor, that I need to call you as another pastor. I need to call you because you won't tell my business. And the person told me his business. And as I listened to him, I said, "You feel like giving up? I just feel like giving up." I said, "Let me tell you something. I've been through something 18 years ago. And because 18 years passed doesn't mean I don't want to mess up tomorrow. I mean, today. You take this thing one day at a time. Pastor, what can you do for me? Pray. That's all I got. When Jesus comes back, I have no decision to make for you. So stop giving your stuff to tramplers who will trample your stuff that will trample you, that will say you nothing but you're no good, you're messed up, you don't deserve this, you don't deserve that. I'm trying to tell you right now that this Bible is telling us right now that they will turn again and rend you. That's why we got to learn to talk to Jesus. Now, folks, I want you to, I'm setting you up for this last one. I'm setting you up because all the issues you're going through in your life, all the mess ups you're going through, all the struggling you're struggling, there's an end to the struggling. So the squirrel falls inside of the bin. I never heard the squirrel fall inside the bin. I don't know when the squirrel fell inside the bin. In fact, the man that came to take it out, because I didn't want to. My wife was like, "Well, just take the squirrel out and put it in the plastic bag." I said, "You take the squirrel out and put it in the plastic bag." Called my brother. My brother said, "I'll be there in the morning. Now I need this thing out now." Nobody wanted to come, so I paid someone. Someone said to me, "You, if you're going to pay that person that much money, it's not that much money, but give that person money, I'll come down there and take it out. Let me pay the person. Come and take it out." The person said to me, when I watched from the window him taking it out, the squirrel was, of course, bloated. He said to me, "The squirrel has been in here for days." Did you hear what I just said? When he took the squirrel out and put it inside of the bag, he coughed. Not the squirrel, him. I said, "Man, are you okay?" He said, "Was such a stench." When he turned over the water and I went back the next day, the grass and everything was still filled with the stench of the smell of the water. And I replayed in my mind what could have happened to the squirrel. The squirrel seemed to have been on the branches above my porch, fell inside, and probably could swim, but not that long. And I'm thinking about this squirrel struggling inside. No one to help. Couldn't call other squirrels to say, turn this thing over. Couldn't call others. I'm thinking, how could the squirrel have been saved? God, why would you let the squirrel fall in there? And I don't know the answer, but I know this much, that I know the squirrel didn't fall in there and did not struggle. I know that that squirrel struggled. And I got things about squirrels. When I'm driving, I brake for squirrels. I do. And when I see a squirrel that didn't make it going across the street, I always say, Lord, I feel sorry for animals on the street. But now there's one in my backyard. Then I'm starting to think, if I just emptied the water the day before, what if I just emptied the water the day before? And God is saying, I didn't ask you to empty the water. Well, God, what if I just didn't put it there? I'm now blaming myself for a squirrel that fell and struggled in the water. God says, I want you to think about this. How many times have you fell? How many times have you fallen? And you dropped inside of a bin like that. And I got you out. How many times have you struggled and also given up? And I think more of the times that I've given up more than I've made it. God said to me today, 2 days ago, he said, I want you to struggle so that when you're delivered, you don't want to struggle like that no more. When you're delivered. Listen, I didn't say if. He says when. So I finally found out why the struggle was so difficult. I found out the struggle was so difficult because every time we struggle on our own. I don't ever remember asking God to take this from me. I don't ever remember saying, God, I'm struggling with this. Just do what you do. But I remember saying to God, man, just get me through this. Instead of asking, I need you to stay with me. John, but if I give this up, I'm so used to how I cope in the struggle that if I give up the struggle, where am I going to go from there? Can we talk? This is not me, but can we talk? Like, if I'm stressed and have anxiety over something, and I pray and I feel better about it, but I've been smoking weed to get me through that, I don't want to give up the weed because it's immediate. If I talk to God, I got to wait. Y'all not hearing me yet. If I'm listening to music and it makes me feel good and it's not gospel. But I know if I listen to this gospel music, it'll center me. But God, in my struggle, I don't want to be centered. I just want you to let me go through what I'm going through. God is telling us, Sister Green, God is telling us in verse 7, ask. I never put it together before. But the reason why we're still struggling is because we haven't asked. And we're not asking because we like the struggle. So ask and it shall be given unto you. That's what the text says. It says, ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be open unto you. And for everyone that asks to be delivered will receive deliverance. I don't know about you, but I want you to understand that I've been reading this text the wrong door. I've been reading this text wrong. God is asking me not to judge others. First, clean yourself. Come on, somebody, so you can help the next person. Then he says, but be careful that even if you have an issue, don't talk to anybody about it, because if you do, they don't know how to handle that. And then I need you to understand that your struggle is not unto death. While you're struggling, I call you holy. While you're struggling, you're my pearl. I saved you from the dogs and the swine, but you want to go back to them because you figure what they have to say is more important. I'm telling you that in your struggle, God sees you as holy. And if you can stomach the fact that you struggle and he calls you his pearls and call you holy, then he says, then whatever you need, ask me. Come on, ask me. Ask me what you need. Ask me. Ask me. You got that issue? Ask me. You got a problem? Ask me. You don't think you're worthy? Ask me. Anything you ask of me in my name, I'll give it to you. So if you ask, I'll give it. If you seek, I'll find it for you. If you knock, I'll open doors for you. So your struggle is holy. Don't give what's holy to the dogs. In fact, according to the word, Paul writes, beware. Beware them dogs. I believe somebody here is struggling. Yeah, I do. I believe. What's so beautiful, I don't even know what it is. God knows and you know. He still sees you as holy. You know, sometimes somebody asked me a question the other day, and I know to the greens I bother you all the time, but I see you guys as our leaders. I see these guys as the ones that are between us. And sometimes when I hear Brother Donald or Brother Ronald Green get on and you make statements like, I'm struggling, they always make statements like that. Like, struggling with what? I hear Sister Gloria. Seriously, get on and say, man, she'll even post on Facebook, man, I'm dealing with something, man, God be with me. I'm mad. I'm like, you struggling with what? I look at some of our patriarchs in here. I'd be like, what you struggling with? And I realized that I was talking to someone who was younger than me. I'm 53, and I said, man, I'm struggling with, and these 20-year-olds looking at me, struggling with what? Talking to my daughter, and she's like, what are you struggling with? Dad, you struggle? I said, girl, move. I said, the difference between me and you, I got the money to struggle. You don't. Which means all of us. So, Amanda, I know I didn't know you were going to be here today. When we were taking that drive to New York, I wish I could have answered you better. Whatever you were struggling with, I wish I could have answered you better. But now I can answer you, Amanda, that whatever your struggle is, there's deliverance at the end of it. And whatever your struggle is, you're holy. So, God, thank you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Shay, we're talking how, why this is our church. And, you know, I like to discuss things and throw wrenches, but we're like, it doesn't fit the mold. That's what we were saying. And I'm like, well, not fitting the mold is fitting the mold. But I knew what you were talking about. Because this is the Hope Dealers over here. Guys, this is the Hope Dealers. And it's not that we got it. It's that God is taking the planks out and we want to take out the specs. And he just calling us. We don't even know why we're here. We're here. Because we're looking for something deeper. We know God is saying, I choose you. Will you come? That's it. We're here for a reason. Tithing offering, that's an investment. That's an investment. We know what investment. You put money away to use it later. That's what it is. I teach. I have to take it seriously because parents, I teach in a private school. That means parents are investing money they can use for vacations, for so many different things that I'm bringing my child here for 8 hours. That's an investment. I don't know what you can do, but do something. And this week was a week of prayer. And I had to take that investment and give it back to God. So I don't have to tell you what to do with tithing offering. You know you're coming with your tithing offering because you're investing. We pray today for finances. God already got it. We heard today, if your finance is a struggle, God is going to turn into something holy. Just know that whatever you need, I'm listening that whatever you need for a season, God already gave it to you to get through that season. You already have what you need. It's just a trust and a love. So tithing offering is just, I trust my investment. And I trust God's investment more than any, more than my retirement, more than my health care, more than anything, I trust the investment. So trust the investment. We already know what I'm going to pray for tithing offering is what I pray for our finances. We have stuff to do, and God has to provide the resources. And I'm not asking because I have to beg God. I'm like, release the resources so we can use it. Just help us to be good stewards. So that's my prayer for tithing offering. God already going to supply all of our needs according to his riches. In glory, let's bow our heads, close eyes for prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for loving us more than we realize sometimes. Thank you. I needed the reminder that the struggle is holy and we can trust you with it. Even when we can't trust ourselves, our families, or the people around us, but we understand the struggle so we can support each other, we can pray for each other, and we know as we leave that you will give us the peace, the joy,
the acknowledgement, the relationship that we so long for, and you have opened us up so you can fill us up. We are not empty, Father. Help us to see it differently. We're not empty vessels. We're opened vessels so that you can fill us to the maximum. Thank you for all that you have given our spirit and our souls this morning, your Sabbath day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. I'm just going to simply say, for those who are watching online, thank you for joining us. Thank you for being with us. And for our afterglow, we are not doing our afterglow like we usually do it. Okay, yes. For those who are online, I want you to know also that next week we'll not be having church online next week. But you can follow us on Facebook, and you'll know where we'll be at 2 o'clock. We'll be joining another church, and we'll let you know what that looks like at 2 o'clock. But there'll be no live services online next week, okay? And for those watching online, be blessed. Share this with others. Be blessed. As we're dismissing, I usually take this time, or for those who are visiting with us, we usually take this time to talk a little bit about the service or what worked for you during this time.